If there's one car that everyone nowadays should look up to for being solely responsible for the current weather of the car market today, dominated by crossovers and SUVs, one car that everyone can say totally changed the game and reinvented the wheel and should be hands down a future classic. It opened our eyes to a whole new world of possibilities. That riding high doesn't have to mean being a millionaire or hacendero by buying the contemporary field masters or safaris of the day. No, this car single-handedly, like you said, changed the game, and what we have here is the aforementioned future classic. This here is the first generation Honda CR-V. A survivor. The Godfather.
I got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 niggas wanna war, 10 niggas on the floor, 11 niggas on the porch, 12 killers wanna war, 13 carnivores, 14 labradors, 15 dinosaurs, 16 avatars, 17 bombs and grenades at your rental car, 18 ways you can...
The Honda CR-V bases itself on the Honda Civic EK platform, but the geniuses at Honda showcased the versatility of their chassis design by simply giving the car some growth hormones and lifted it to house the crossover's unibody. Some people might argue that the RAV4 came first and should maintain all the praise, but I'm giving that to the CR-V. Cause you know, how many RAV4s do you still see on the road? Compared to this CR-V, not very much. The CR-V was praised not just for its rugged styling, but its legitimate claim to its off-roading sensibilities. Only available in a 4x4 configuration in the Philippines, it wouldn't be weird to see one being kitted with a trail kit for heavy trekking duties. Now before the CR-V and the RAV4, for argument's sake, your choice of vehicles were severely limited to a full-on body-on-frame SUVs. Truck-based SUVs were a few years away, so you had to take your pick from either the Land Cruiser, Pajero, Patrol, which are all very capable cars, mind you, and cars which we still feature on this channel soon, but is way, way out of reach for the common Filipino household. Sedans were considered the kings of the passenger car market, which was dominated by the likes of the Lancer, the Corolla, Sentra, and the previously mentioned Honda Civic. SUVs were considered as luxury items, aspirational purchases that you can only buy if you either were born with a silver spoon or won the lottery. Of course, there will always be the Toyota Tamro FX or even the Isuzu Highlander and Mitsubishi Adventure in the early 2000s, but those were on the other side of the spectrum. No matter how much car companies try to market them as cool, hip vehicles, they would always ultimately become workhorses and fleet cars for public utility. Enter the crossover segment. Instead of the body-on-frame design of your typical SUVs and AUVs at the time, you had this unibody construction not unlike sedans, giving engineers more freedom to make it sleeker, more comfortable, and more importantly, affordable and versatile. On the outside, the CR-V looks all business with its boxy proportions and high ride height. The only indication that you might have that this is based on the popular Honda Civic EKs are those headlamps. Although they have totally different shapes, the similarities of the light cluster and construction is undeniable. You can call the design of the CR-V timeless because of how it stands up to even current crossovers available on the market. It has a full-size spare in the back that proudly screams SUV. Now, I personally find that keeping the spare tire easy to reach right there is so much easier than having to be on all fours trying to pry it out from underneath like other SUVs. Plus, it adds more to its rugged off-roading appeal. My favorite part of the CR-V is just how intricate this multi-piece rear door is. So to put stuff inside, you don't have to swing the entire door open. It's a two-stage design where you can open the rear windows independently of the entire rear hatch. If you need to insert bigger items, you then have the ability to swing the lower part of the construction sideways. It's definitely one of a kind, and you won't find this implementation anywhere else today. How in the world Honda was able to engineer this feature flawlessly, in the mid-90s no less, is baffling. You get your standard roof rails up top, which you can place even more cargo on, and probably a surfboard if you feel like shredding a gnar in La Union, because you're that person now with a CR-V. This particular model features a CR-V Performa catalog package, which features a more aggressive front and rear bumper side moldings, and among other things, a third side mirror, which you might find odd because the parallel parking mirror should be on the other side, but keep in mind this package was meant for JDM markets, so it's on the right side of the road. Jeff, the owner, was proud of the fact that he was able to source his parts for this bad boy. You see, this is his college car, and it's been in his family for quite some time, and once the keys were handed over to him, he built the CR-V to his own specifications and design. Inside, you'll find an exterior that belies his off-roading and rugged aspirations. The side door panels are rubberized, making them easy to clean. All the instrument panels and gauges are legible and straightforward. Now, Honda believes in man maximum, machine minimum, even during the 90s, even before they came up with that term, and is evident everywhere you see on the inside. The seats are supportive and comfy, even after two decades, and Honda probably made these conscious decisions knowing CR-V owners wouldn't mind taking these cars off-road at a short notice. And this car still rips. This car features the Honda B20Z non-VTEC engine, a 2-liter inline-4 DOHC that makes a very respectable, even for today's crop, 150 very rugged macho caballos and 180 Nm of torque. Now, it's the same family of engines that you can find on those Civic EK Type R's, Integra Type R's, and even the SIR, but has a bigger displacement and tuned for torque more than horsepower. This engine also replaces the B20B engine found in earlier models, which had lower power figures all in all. You've probably heard of the CR-V's infamous fuel consumption of around 6 to 7 kilometers per liter, if you take it easy. But if you put that into perspective and factor in the cost of actually paying for a new car, the price you pay is a real steal. As with all Hondas, the engine is so well made that even after 20 years of existence, everything still feels so tight. If the suspension ride height seems a bit unusual to you, unlike any other CR-Vs, it's because Jet took the parts from a Civic. The setup paired with 16-inch Rota grid ones give it a more planted stance and looks ready to do battle with even more contemporary crossovers. Driving it around feels right, as if the last 20 years didn't matter. The level of engineering given to the CR-V is unmatched. It's as if Honda made this car to actually last. Remember when things were used to be made that way? Instead, we live in a world of planned obsolescence. Listen up, boys and girls. Planned obsolescence is an economic and industrial term to describe a manufacturing paradigm in which both manufacturers and consumers know a particular item will be out of date, broken, or considered obsolete by a newer model. It has become quite a norm in gadgets such as smartphones, desktops, laptop computers, and yes, even cars. Industrialization has left us jaded and has made us forget the thought of owning something for a lifetime. We are dangerously getting close to a reality wherein if something breaks, we just throw it away. This CR-V revolts and stands up against that mindset, refusing to bog down despite the availability of other newer models. Jet plans to run his CR-V to the ground, fix it, drive it again until it no longer makes financial sense to keep it. Honda's initial plan was just to bring an SUV to a wider market, making something so much cheaper available to more people. But what they did was engineer and design a crossover so perfectly that it now refuses to die. Just like Jet, who, by the way, just graduated. Congratulations, buddy, and thanks for sharing your ride with me. May this CR-V serve you well in your new chapter in life. Thanks for watching, and I hope you liked the last episode of Season 1 of Mototelic. We're about to move into so much more things, introduce new segments, and of course review even more cars. Please give us a like if you love this video, and don't forget to subscribe. Tell us what you think about the CR-V, or if you have any suggestions, feel free to drop us a line in the comment section below. See you guys next time.